All right. After some technical difficulties, we got the screens also to show here, which kind of helps the speakers. So it's my pleasure to open the first session, which is lattice-based cryptography, and to announce the first speaker, Gregor Seiler, which is, who's speaking on joint work with Vadim Lubashevsky on stuttering in NTT RU, truly fast entry using NTT.
Yeah. So good morning. It's nice to open this chess. I hope maybe not everybody in the room is as tired as I am. I'm going to speak about a lattice-based chem, which is called NTT RU, and which is basically a version of ANTRU using NTT, which means a number theoretic transform for fast polynomial arithmetic. And yeah, so this is a joint work with my advisor, Vadim. To motivate this work, let me make a few observations. So first, especially if we look at LWE schemes, at the moment we see that in these schemes, polynomial arithmetic has basically become so fast that in the runtime of these schemes, symmetric key tasks like getting pseudorandomness, these tasks make up for the majority of runtime. So we basically cannot speed up these schemes in software very much anymore. On the other hand, if we look at ANTRU, then there the situation is that you actually need much less pseudorandomness. And the main reason for this is that there is no big uniform public polynomial that you have to expand at some point. And also the arithmetic, in a sense, is more complicated. And the reason for this is that during key generation, you have to invert some polynomial, and this is a pretty expensive operation. And so then basically the next observation we made is that if you look at the NIST competition, then there are a couple of ANTRU schemes in submission, but none of them uses the NTT for fast arithmetic. So we thought that we can actually speed up ANTRU over what is possible with LWE schemes. And yeah, so this was the goal of this work. So we designed some variant of ANTRU HISS, which is one of the NIST ANTRU submissions, by using a variant of the number theoretic transform. And also what is important here is that if one does this in the same way as, for example, New Hope, where one uses a ring of dimension a power of 2, then one is in a bit of a bad situation that one has basically only the choice between too little security and too large sizes, because somehow, for example, ANTRU HISS uses a ring of dimension 700. This seems to be somewhat a sweet spot for lattice-based cryptography at the moment, and if you use 512, then you don't get enough security, and 1024 gives you very big sizes. So this means we needed to use some non-power of 2 entity, and I want to basically now spend the whole talk and not so much focus on ANTRU, the scheme itself, and more on how one can do a non-power of 2 entity for fast polynomial arithmetic. And yeah, so after this introduction, let me start with some recap of the basic so-called cyclic NTT. And what one does there is one takes a primitive nth root of unity, let's call it zeta, and what the NTT then computes is basically it takes a polynomial f of degree smaller than n and evaluates this f at all the nth roots of unity. And now, since all these roots are roots of the polynomial x to the n minus 1, we get that this is actually an isomorphism from this ring. Oh, this didn't work. Yeah. so this ring to basically n copies of ZQ. And because of this isomorphism, it means we can do fast arithmetic, and in particular multiplication and division in this ring by doing very easy coefficient-wise arithmetic in ZQ to the n. And now the problem is that in lattice cryptography, we want to use a ring basically of this form, which is ZQ X modulo some, modulo some polynomial, but this polynomial phi needs to be irreducible over the integers. So therefore, x to the n minus 1 is not really a good choice, or not something we can do for lattice cryptography. And so what many schemes now do that use the entity is they use this very similar polynomial x to the n plus 1, which is irreducible if n is a power of 2. And if you do then some entity algorithm in this ring modulo x to the n plus 1, then this is called the negacyclic entity. And yeah, now to explain how we do a non-power of 2 case and how to also compute such an entity quickly, I introduce some more algebraic viewpoint. And this is that basically the fact that there is a primitive nth root of unity in ZQ, this means that this polynomial x to the n minus 1 splits into linear factors. And then by the Chinese remainder theorem, we know that the ring we're interested in is actually a product of many rings of rank 1. And since this Chinese remainder map, this works by reducing some polynomial in here, modulo all these linear factors, we see that really the entity is nothing else than this Chinese remainder ring map. And basically this algebraic viewpoint directly also gives us an understanding how we can compute this in a fast way. And the idea is that we can basically use this Chinese remainder ring in a recursive fashion. So we start with our original ring and then see that this polynomial x to the n minus 1, this is a product of these two polynomials of degree n over 2. And then again, by the Chinese remainder theorem, we can basically in the first step just reduce our polynomial in here modulo these two smaller polynomials. And then we continue this in a divide and conquer fashion. And the reason why the entity is such a nice algorithm and is fast is that basically reducing modulo such simple polynomials, which are basically only have two monomials, this is a very fast operation. So we just continue this. On the left side, it's exactly the same as the first step. On the right side, we notice that plus 1 can be written as minus minus 1, which is zeta to the n over 2. And then we split this by extracting a further square root. Yeah, and then one just continues until, basically as much step as one wants. This is also an important observation, that there is actually no reason for fast polynomial arithmetic to do this entity down to linear factors. You can basically stop as early as you want and still have some algorithm to multiply or to do arithmetic, because all these splitting steps, they are actually isomorphisms. And now to see what an optimal way for the negacyclic entity is you basically just have to compute some right part of such a tree. And with this view onto the entity, we can understand what we can do if we don't have a power of 2. So this is what we did in our scheme. We chose this ring, which is modulo some cyclotomic polynomial of degree 768. And then as modulus, we wanted to choose a prime which is not much bigger as the modulus in Andrew LHISS. So we chose 7681, which has the property that this cyclotomic polynomial only splits into factors of degree 3. So not linear factors, but as I said before, this is not really a problem. And now to get basically some entity-like algorithm to split this ring, the most interesting step is how to make a first splitting, basically. So if you look at this polynomial of degree 768 and play around with it, then you find that it has actually many factors of lower degree which retain this structure, so which still have three monomials. But this is not really what you want, because reducing modulo polynomial of this form is more expensive than you want in an entity algorithm. But if you look further, then you find that this is a polynomial, is a product of x to the 384 minus the two sixth root of unity in your ring. And so after you have basically computed the polynomial or the reduction of the polynomial, you start with modulo these factors, you are in the situation where you have that you have in a power of two entity. So you have these nice polynomials which have only two monomials, and then splitting this further is just basically the same radix two type thing as in the power of two entity. You basically just extract further square roots of these of the roots you had before. So now if we look at the first splitting, then on first sight this looks a bit more expensive than a usual radix two splitting because there's these two different roots of unity. But since they are a solution of this equation, we see that the other sixth root of unity is actually just one minus the first one. So if we replace this in the second polynomial, it gets obvious that we just have to multiply by one root of unity to do this splitting. So also the first splitting is really not much more expensive than a usual radix two splitting. So much for how this entity of dimension 768 works. Now the question is if you want to implement this in a fast way on AVX2, then the part which basically determines how fast your algorithm is how you do these multiplications with the roots of unity. So remember, you have a polynomial, you want to split it, so you need to multiply the upper half by root of unity and then add or subtract this to or from the lower part. And these multiplications, you have basically two choices how to do this in a vectorized setting. So you can either pack only 16-bit coefficients in 256-bit registers. So you basically leave room 32-bit for each coefficients. And then if you multiply by root of unity, you basically have space for these intermediate 32-bit results that appear before you reduce modulo q. Or a different approach is you use that AVX2 has these two nice instructions where you can multiply basically 16-bit integers and get the low and high words separately in two separate registers. So this is basically the approach we used, but this is only since you don't really want to do multi-precision arithmetic with these low and high parts. What you need is a reduction algorithm that somehow naturally handles this case that your input is given in this low and high part representation. And this is such an algorithm actually exists, and this is what I want to explain next. It's basically just a variant of the Montgomery reduction algorithm, but we really need signed arithmetic here. So normally Montgomery reduction is defined with unsigned arithmetic, but the situation is very similar if you use signed arithmetic. So remember that this algorithm computes something which is called a Hensel remainder, which basically differs from a usual Euclidean remainder only in that your remainder is scaled by some factor 2 to the minus 16 modulo q. And if you look at this defining equation of this Hensel remainder, you immediately get how to compute this. So you just multiply your integer c by q inverse mod 2 to the 16. This gives you m. Then you multiply m by q, subtract this from c, so only this part remains, which is r to the 2 to the 16. And then you just divide out 2 to the 16 by some shift and get this Hensel remainder. And in our situation now, we have these products which we are given as separately somehow as low part and high part. And the crucial observation now is that the Hensel or the Montgomery reduction algorithm naturally somehow can work with these two inputs separately without ever somehow needing to compute on 32-bit numbers. So in the first step, we needed to multiply by something modulo 2 to the 16. So it's immediate that here we only need the low part. And then in the second part, we multiplied the m we got here by q and subtracted this from c. But if one analyzes this, one sees that this product mq actually has the same low word as c. So we don't need to compute it. And it's actually sufficient to just compute the high word and subtract it from c. And yeah, so then one immediately also gets R and doesn't even need to divide by 2 to the 16. So this is a very fast algorithm which somehow nicely fits into this vectorized setting. And there's one further optimization we do in entity IU. So since we multiply by pre-computable constants, which are these roots of unity, we can also pre-compute these constants with a factor of q to the minus one, and then we don't have to do this first step in the reduction. And what you get in the end is that basically for a full mulmod in ZQ with such a pre-computed root, it is sufficient to just do three half multiplication instructions, which is very fast. Okay, so this is, I hope this gave you some idea about how the arithmetic in NTTIU works. And on this slide, you basically see the result of this. So basically, this is these are the numbers for the finished CHEM, which is a CCA secure key encapsulation mechanism built around the ENTRU one-way function, and the cycles for key generation, which usually are much higher in other ENTRU schemes because they have this polynomial inversion. They are now extremely fast using this NTT arithmetic, and also signing and verification are faster than basically in any other scheme. Size-wise, remember I said in the beginning that ENTRU HISS has a ring of dimension 700. Since our ring is slightly bigger, dimension 768, we get slightly bigger public keys and ciphertext, so they have 1,248 bytes. But this is actually brings me to the last thing I want to say. One can actually do something about this. So what would be a possibility is to not use this 7681 prime, but some smaller prime, namely 3457. There one would need to do a slightly different splitting, but since this prime has one bit less, one basically exactly gains what one loses in this higher dimension compared to ENTRU HISS. So one would basically get the same sizes as ENTRU HISS. There's a small caveat. And this is that smaller modulus results in slightly higher, basically failure probability for decryption. So one would need to analyze this and maybe do something about it. But at least this would be a way to get the sizes down. Maybe some other tweak I want to mention as a last for this talk is what would also be maybe interesting is to basically switch to deterministic noise in ENTRU, and then basically further reduce the amount of pseudorandomness that is used. Okay.
Thank you. We started a minute late, so if there's any questions, please go to the microphones and line up there. I guess lots of math in the morning. All right, if there are no questions, then I'll quickly ask something. Maybe then somebody else gets up and asks one. So you applied this to ENTRU RSS, and of course there are some people who have other ENTRU-like schemes.
Sure, yeah.
So we're making your life harder with ENTRU prime by having a different polynomial. On the other hand, well, could you go to some extension fields, extension sizes to do the same?
So you mean to basically compute ENTRU prime?
With an entity.
Yeah, sure. So there's one way to do this, so you can basically do arithmetic over the integers, not reducing modulo any prime, and then you can do this modulo many entity-friendly primes and recombine the result with the Chinese remainder theorem, and then you reduce later. Yeah, this would give you a speed up for ENTRU prime maybe also, yeah, or at least would be at least competitive with ENTRU prime speed. Yeah.
Thank you. I don't see anybody lined up, so please join me in thanking the speaker again.